Since you can never pray too much, let us prepare our hearts and for the study of the Word of God by entering one more time into the presence of God in prayer. Lord, I feel your presence here today, Lord. That you desire us. You long for us to fulfill the purpose you created us for, that we would glorify you by enjoying you forever, Lord. And Lord, in the midst of the turmoils of life, your grace can feel like a hurricane, making the trees of our lives bow down, Lord. And I pray we experience the tendernesses of your heavenly kiss upon us, Lord, that we would long for more of you, Lord. That despite all of the trials, despite all of the brokennesses of this world, despite all the triumphs and victories, Lord, we would long for more of you. We would lay all of them aside for more of you, Lord. So pray this morning, teach us to treasure you, long for you, desire for your kingdom in a new way. And that we would be willing to get rid of it all so that we could have all of you, Lord. I pray this in your beautiful and holy name. Amen. Well, I am excited. We get to start our first study together. We're going to be doing a study on the Sermon of the Mount over the next, I would say the next X number of weeks, but I don't have any idea how long it's going to take. It will take as long as the Holy Spirit allows us, so it'll probably be interrupted by some Christmas sermons or whatever. But but it's a joy to dive into the Word of God together. That we would dive into the Word of God expectant to hear from Him. That we would not see the pages in a book as just something that collects dust on our shelves, but that we would long for the truths that the Word of God points us to. That we would hear from our Heavenly Father as we read. And so today we're going to start the series on the Sermon on the Mount. And I find the Sermon on the Mount to be one of the most challenging and beautiful passages right now. Actually, I'm a little bit scared of preaching on the Sermon of the Mount, because as I've been reflecting on it and praying over it, I think, oh my goodness, Lord, you've got a lot more work in my life to do to make me prepared to be able to preach a message like this. Isn't there something happy that I can do? And God keeps saying, I've got something amazing for you. I believe God has something amazing to teach us through the words of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in the Sermon on the Mount. He's going to, I hope, through this series, transform our passions and desires so that we see differently how to live out this life that we dedicate to Him. And really the question we will be asking throughout this entire series is what is our treasure? What is it that we are treasuring most? Because it's quite often the thing we should be treasuring is not actually the thing we really are treasuring. The things we put our hopes and desires and investments into aren't the things that God has asked us to put our hopes and desires and investments into. And as we look specifically, so what we're going to do today is a big overview of the Sermon on the Mount. We're going to look at kind of its structure and what it's about. But before we do that, I really want to focus us in on this question of what is your treasure? Because I think if you look throughout the entire Gospel of Matthew, you will see this question coming up again and again and again. What are you putting your value, your treasure, and your trust into? Because if we are putting our trust in any other kingdom, it will fail. It will fade away. It will also change how we are generous with the things that God has entrusted to us. In the scriptures, we talk about a tithe. A tithe is a beautiful principle. It's a way for us to display our trust in God with our things. It's that we can say, this, you know, I'm have the opportunity to make this money, this wealth, this whatever, and I'm giving it back to you, God. It's an act of worship when we give our money to God. But we'll find out in the Sermon on the Mount that God doesn't want 10%. It's not like, oh, this 10% is God's, all the rest is mine, I get to do with it as I want, it's my wild money, I get to, you know, spend it however I please. It's all God's. It is all God's. He even created the molecules that make up the little metal in the coins that we spend. He holds it all together. So the question is what do we do with, what do we treasure and what do we do with what we treasure? And in Matthew chapter 19, we'll start by looking at the back of Matthew and then kind of work our way back to the front. In Matthew chapter 19, there's a rich young man comes to Jesus, and he's excited to come to Jesus because this exciting miracle worker is teaching this exciting new kingdom, and he wants a part of it. And this is what the rich young ruler asks of Jesus in Matthew 19, starting in verse 16. And behold, a man came up to him, saying, "Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "Why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. If you want to enter life, keep the commandments." He said to him, "Which ones?" Jesus said, "You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself." The young man said to him, "All this I have kept. What do I still lack?" Jesus said to him, "If you would be perfect, go. Sell what you possess and give to the poor. And you will have treasure in heaven. Come and follow me." When the young man heard this, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. What must I do to inherit the kingdom of God? There's kind of an irony in his question. He's saying, you know, I've done all these good things. I've worked this all with my own hands. What must I do to inherit the kingdom of God? This is in Matthew chapter 19. In a very few short passages, Jesus will be hanging on the cross, doing the one thing that makes it possible so that we could inherit the kingdom of God. And so in this very ironic sort of way, this man is saying, what can I do, when he's talking to the only person who can? He's looking at all of the different things that he can do to inherit eternal life, and He's missing the mark. Jesus says to him, he lists off the Ten Commandments. He says, you know, don't bear false witness, don't lie, don't commit adultery, honor your father and mother. But if you notice, Jesus left out something in that list of commandments. He left off the first four commandments. You shall have no other gods, no engraven images. Do not take the Lord's name in vain. Remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. Those first four commandments are about loving God, treasuring God, putting God above all else. And Jesus left those out because he knew this young man had put his own wealth above the wealth of the kingdom of God. And Jesus says to him, go sell all you have and give to the poor. And here's the interesting thing. There is a promise in this passage. He says, sell what you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. He is pointing to an eternal treasure, an eternal reward. He's essentially saying you cannot inherit eternal life because you are valuing the wrong wealth and the wrong kingdom. You are valuing your own kingdom over God's kingdom. You are valuing earthly wealth when I have eternal value and eternal wealth for you. And I hope that never becomes me. I hope that never becomes me where my own wealth and my own ability blinds me to my need for Jesus as my Savior. That apart from what Jesus did for me on the cross, apart from his death, burial, and resurrection, apart from him putting his Holy Spirit in my heart, I have no right to call my God Father. But I can call my God Father because of what Jesus did for me. He literally gave up everything to the point where they're gambling over his clothes while he hangs on a cross so that I could call God Father. So the question becomes when we look at passages like this and like the Sermon on the Mount, what am I treasuring? And the danger is that we would allow the things, the good things that God has given to us to steward well, we would allow those things to blind us from seeing the wealth that we have in eternity. And this isn't just about the size of our bank account, because I've known wealthy people who have clinged to their wealth, and they saw their wealth as a way to manipulate and push their own agendas and advance their own kingdoms. I've seen wealthy people who are generous beyond measure, who see it all as belonging to God, and don't consider their wealth anything but something to be used for his glory and kingdom. I've seen poor people who all they are interested in is winning the next big score. That they aren't trustworthy and they haven't put their faith in eternal kingdom. I've seen poor people who have put me to shame with their generosity. That's one of the things about living in Senegal is that we as Americans don't realize how wealthy a people we are. How profoundly wealthy we are just to hold citizenship in the nation, United States. And so then I go to Senegal and I see genuine poverty, but in the midst of that, I find people who have joy in their eternal kingdom. And they are giving me out of their complete lack generously. And it breaks me to the core because I look at myself and I say, am I one-tenth as profound, as generous as this man's generosity is? And they bring me to their knees with the wealth of their generosity because these people know where their eternal treasure is. If tomorrow God took everything away from us, will we turn to Him for our treasure and security? Or will we try to quickly rebuild what we lost so that we could feel safe? Where is your treasure? And how much do you value it? In Matthew chapter 13, verses 44 through 52, we read the next passage. And these are three beautiful, beautiful parables that Jesus gives. Starting in verse 44, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man finds found and covered up. Then, in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net thrown into the sea and gathered fish of every kind. When it was full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. So it will be at the close of the age, the angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the fire furnace. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all these things? They said to him. Yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. The kingdom of heaven is worth everything. Absolutely everything. That we would see it as such a great treasure that we would be willing to sell everything so that we could have access to the treasure that is in the kingdom of heaven. Think about my five beautiful children. I think about how cool would it be if one day I wasn't able to go see them any chance I wanted because they would be at the four corners of the earth sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. Would I be willing to allow the kids God has given me to go off and be sent out into the world for His glory? How cool would it be as if Maranatha continued to give through its wealth of people, messengers, the furthest corners of the earth. Maybe we'll become that missionary sending church that leads the last person to Christ and then Jesus returns. But we can't do that unless we see the value of the kingdom of heaven. And we desire to put the value of the kingdom of heaven above every other wealth and thing. Here's the important question we must ask. This is the question we must ask each one of ourselves, is what do I do with the things that God has given me to steward. The things we have, they are not our own. My children are not my children. They are God's children, and I have been given them to steward and to raise in the name of Jesus. The wealth that I have, they are not, it is not my own. The vehicles in the driveway out there, they are not my own. Even my couch cushions and the change in that marker cap that somehow never seems to find the other end of the marker that's on the other end of the couch underneath that cushion. It's not my own. It is to be used for the glory of the kingdom of God. And I need to constantly remind myself, there is a treasure of great value, a pearl of great price. And would I be willing to sell it all so that I could have access to an eternal treasure? In a few moments, we will be reading through the Sermon on the Mount. I think it's important to read through large sections of scriptures together. Because frankly, listening to me bloviate is not nearly as profound as the Word of God expressed. And so my desire is that as we listen through Jesus' sermon, that we would begin to say, Lord, how are you going to transform my heart as we study over this passage over the next couple of weeks? So before we do that, I'd like to just kind of outline a structure for you so you kind of see how the sermon flows. Because I do think that the writer of Matthew intends for this sermon to be read as an entire piece. One of the dangers is that we often read small sections of the Bible without reading it as if it were one complete work. And when we do that, we don't understand that when we're talking about putting our treasures where moth and rust don't destroy, that's in the context of the Beatitudes where we blessed are the poor in spirit, whose theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And we need to understand it all fits together. Even as we're going, you know, verse by verse, line by line, section by section, that we wouldn't forget that each section is part of a whole. And it is put together that way so that God can tell us very important things about himself and that we can grow in deeper relationship with him. So in Matthew chapter 5, the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, that's verses 2 through 16. This is the Beatitudes. And this lays out, what does it look like to be a person of the kingdom? What does a kingdom person look like to Jesus? And it is going to turn everything upside down. Frankly, that's one of the reasons why I'm kind of terrified to preach this passage. It's because of the Beatitudes. They are wonderful and blessed. Yet at the same time, it's, do I allow myself to really experience this truth that blessed are the poor in spirit? Do I allow that to sit on my soul and begin to say, what does that mean? But it's important to understand this because then Jesus, and then the next part of chapter 5, verses 17 through 48, he's going to talk about the law. And when we talk about the law, or like if I talk about the law, I'm like, well, take the speed limit, for instance. Speed limit's an easy one. It's a, you know, it's speed limit was 70 on the interstate heading back up from vacation. But, you know, I mean, 70, what? Everybody else is doing, you know, 75, 80. So if I go 75, if I go 80, nobody's going to notice. There's a grace, you know, there's a grace buffer zone in the speed limit anyway. So, you know, and And as we tend to explore the laws, we tend to loosen them up, kind of like our belts after Thanksgiving dinner, so they fit better. But that's not what Jesus is going to do. He's going to tighten them down. He's going to show that what the law gets at isn't just behavior. Certainly behavior outflows from it, but what is in the law is about our hearts. And so he's going to tighten it down really, really tight. And it's going to be very uncomfortable if we don't understand the Beatitudes. If we don't enter into it broken, dependent on Jesus already, then it's going to become, it's going to turn our legalism up to 1,000. I often think of my backyard when I think about this section. Especially at the last place we lived, there in the beginning when we first got there wasn't really a fence in the front. And so you tell the kids, don't cross this line. So you go and you go, don't cross this line. What are the first thing the kid is going to do when you say, don't cross this line? They're going to, I'm not crossing it. And so they will come all the way up to the line and they'll be so concerned about that line. And that is 1/1,000th of the entire backyard. If they were just to turn around and look at the backyard, they would see me in the center, ready to play with them. A yard full of toys and a father longing to play with them. And yet, instead, we're so concerned about the boundary right in front of us. People love to come up to me, Pastor, is it a sin if I... I've never heard somebody say, Pastor, will I glorify God better if I... Is it a sin if I do this? Is a question of kids standing at a boundary line, pretending not to put their feet over. Say, well, you know, doing the speed limit game. Where it's like, well, if I go 71, that's not, well, I mean, nobody's going to know that this, my speedometer's probably off anyway. And so then you giving yourself leeway to step over that line and fall into sin. When God says, there is an entire backyard, there's an entire kingdom I want you to play in. And I am at the center of it. And I want to enjoy it with you. I want you to enjoy it because of me. So the law section, I hope when we get there, it turns our eyes away from that boundary line and to our Lord and Savior. That we would stop playing at the boundary line and we would live like people who have been given the kingdom. And that we would be transformed by it. In chapter 6, verses 1 through 18, we start to see what does it mean when we seek our reward? What does it mean to seek access to our King and Father? Because there's people who seek access to a king, but it's not the eternal king. They are the kings of their own lives, where they either wish everybody to know how awesome and spiritual they are, or else they're trying to manipulate God into doing whatever they want. And God wants them to see that they have a relationship with their Heavenly Father. And so, it ends with the sermon on, the, or with the That section ends with the Lord's Prayer, that we see that the relationship with God is at the center of the gospel. There's this horrible, horrible heresy that's going through Africa and, frankly, much of the United States is called the prosperity gospel, where it says, if I get things, if I'm living in health and things, and then I know that I'm in the right place with the kingdom. And then what happens is these things turn in to the point of the gospel. The prosperity becomes the point. The gift becomes more important than the person who gave the gift. And in the Gospels, we have something different. We have prosperity in the Gospel. And the prosperity in the Gospel is the presence of our Heavenly Father. In the Matthew or Luke chapter 11, where Jesus gives us the Lord's Prayer in Luke, he says, after giving the Lord's Prayer, he says, okay, you parents who know how to give good gifts to your kids, you know, you wouldn't give them a snake if they asked for a rock. Or you wouldn't give them a rock if they asked for bread, and you wouldn't give them a snake if they asked for a fish. And you guys are evil. So how much better gifts will the Heavenly Father give? How much more, he says, how much more the Holy Spirit will the Heavenly Father give to those who ask him? The prosperity of the gospel is to be known by our Heavenly Father, to have more of his presence in our lives through the power of the Holy Spirit. And so I hope that we pursue the prosperity of the gospel, but the prosperity of the gospel is more of our Heavenly Father. And often he takes us through very difficult roads to get there. And in those difficult roads, if we have the mindset of it's all his anyway, then as we pass through those roads, we know that he is doing something good, even when it doesn't feel like it. He's transforming our souls so that we can be vessels that can receive even more of the Holy Spirit. And then in 6:19 through 34, he talks about real treasure. Real treasure does not rob, does not rust, it cannot be robbed, it cannot be raised, it cannot be destroyed. So that when we are confronted with those brokennesses of life and our anxieties are starting to get out of control, we can trust in the God of eternal treasure. Matthew 7, verses 1 through 14. This shows us how we can have confidence when we approach our Heavenly King. It says, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find. That we know that when we are approaching our King, he is not a God who's just simply general of armies, but a good Father, the good Father. And so this portion shows us how we can give up everything again and have more of him. And then finally, it ends with a warning, actually, of what does it mean to identify those who are of the kingdom of God? And we'll, in those passages, approach probably some of the most terrifying verses in all of the Bible. But we can approach it with confidence because we took care to see it in its full context. We approach it with confidence because we know that the brokenness that God is taking us through, like the song we sung right before the message, that the brokenness God is taking us through, he is good and faithful and doing something in the midst of it. Where is your treasure? Where do you put your ultimate treasure? And what are you willing to relinquish and give up so that you can have full access to the treasure promised to you in Jesus Christ? I'm going to start. I'm going to read, and then after I'm done, I'm just going to turn it over to the worship team to lead us through the next portion of our service. So Matthew chapter 5, starting in verse 1. And feel free to just allow the words to pour over your heart, to just listen. And imagine what would it have been like to be there, really there, when Jesus gave those words to the disciples. What would it have been like if you were there listening to Jesus give these words? And just allow the words of these texts to pour over you. Verse 1. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand. It gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law of the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. You've heard it said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders is liable to judgment. Excuse me. But I say to you, everyone who is angry at his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council. And whoever says, you fool, will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there and before the altar and go. First reconcile to your brother, then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge and the judge to the guard and you be put into prison. Truly, I say to you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard it said, you have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. For if your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that the whole body be thrown into hell. If your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body go into hell. It was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the grounds of sexual immorality, makes her commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard it that it was said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform to the Lord what you have sworn. But I say to you, do not take an oath at all, either by heaven, or for it is the throne of God, or by earth, for it is the footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not take an oath by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let what you have said simply be yes or no. Anything more than this comes from evil. You have heard it that it was said, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil. But if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if anyone sue you to take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to the one who begs from you, and do not refuse the one who would borrow from you. You have heard it said, you shall love your neighbor, hate your enemies. But I say to you, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes the sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? You, therefore, must be perfect, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other peoples in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room, shut the door, pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases like the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. And when you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces that their fasting may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Do not lay up for yourself treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. Then the light in you is darkness. How great is the darkness? No one can serve two masters, for he will either hate one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field. How they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of them. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you? Oh, you of little faith. Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Judge not, that you be not judged. For with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you see that speck that is in your brother's eye, but you do not see the log that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me take this speck out of your eye, when there is a log in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the log out of your own eye, then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. Do not give to dogs what is holy, and do not throw your pearls before pigs, lest they trample them underfoot and turn and attack you. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And the one who knocks it will be opened. Or which one of you, if his son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father, who is in heaven, give good things to those who ask him. So whether you wish that others would do to you, so whatever you wish that others do to you, do also to them. For this is the law and the prophets. Enter by the narrow gate. For the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction. And those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life. And those who find it are few. Beware of the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will recognize them by their fruits. Are the grapes gathered from thorn bushes or the figs from thistles? So even the healthy tree bears good fruit, but the diseased tree bears bad fruit. The healthy tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor the diseased tree bear good fruit. Even every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus you will recognize them by their fruits. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on the house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like the foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat against the house and it fell. And great was the and great was the fall of it. And when Jesus finished these sayings, the crowds were astonished at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one who had authority and not as their scribes. The word of the Lord. Heavenly Father, may we be a people of your kingdom, Lord. A people whose treasure is not in these earthly things, Lord, but in your eternal inheritance, Lord. May we say, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus, come, because we anticipate the treasure that awaits us in your kingdom, Lord. So, Lord, use us to make much of your name in Elmira, in Horseheads, in Corning, in New York, the United States, and in the lands beyond, Lord, so that people may know that we are people of your kingdom, Lord, from here until you return. Now, Maranatha, go be a people wealthy in the love of Christ and be generous with that wealth to all you encounter for the glory of our Father forever. Now go in peace and be the church. Amen.
You picked me up. You took me from the truth, you're the light, you're the way. Heaven knows that I won't.